I was brought up to keep my distance from mortal remains. But not the Turaja. Even the children come here to delve into the ark-like coffins. They rearrange and play with the skulls of their families. Lowland pirate tribes would raid these caves for treasure, so the Turaja took to hollowing out vaults in the high cliff faces and balconies, which they lined with totem effigies of their dead, carved in their likeness. Rounding a corner one day, we found them lowering the effigies from the highest vault in the highest cliff. They were cleaning and redressing them for the death rites of the last king of the tribe. The king's first ancestors, they told us, descended from the Pleiades in a starship. They still build their houses in the ark-like forms of that ship to remind them, they say, of their origins. Carved symbols on their walls form a subtle language. From the ground up can be read their entire genealogical tree stretching all the way back to the Pleiades. Across the fields, an entire ceremonial village has been built, just for this occasion, to house the thousands of funeral guests. The village would be torn down afterwards. This is the house of Lasso Rinding Puang Sangala, last king of the Turaja. He had died 4 years before our arrival, and his body had been lying here at home ever since while the tribe prepared for his send-off. For these 4 years, his widow had not left his side. Wrapped in rich textiles, his corpse had long since desiccated, and only the faintest odor of death remained. The girls had kept busy husking rice for the guests who would arrive from the farthest corners of the valley. The rhythm they use is unique to the occasion, an invitation to a feast, the music of death. And the guests arrive. They bring gifts of rice, palm wine, and sacrificial offerings of pigs and water buffalo. The rites of death revolve around the buffalo. For a dead nobleman, dozens must be killed. For the last king, hundreds. This buffalo has never seen a white man before. Before their sacrifice, they are released amongst the crowd. The ceremonial village vibrated to the mabadon, the hypnotic tones which take them into trance. They say they can feel all the past and future generations of their tribe moving through them. Day and night, for a whole month, they chanted. Thank you. At last, the day dawned when the king would be carried to the death cliff and his launch pad back to the stars. Watches are empty jewelry. None of them work. This was the day the really important guests arrived. The delegation sent by the Queen of Lu was headed by her grandson. His general's uniform made up for his tender years. He seemed well prepared for the age to come. Since Indonesian independence, royal succession has been abolished amongst the nation's myriad kingdoms. So never again will there be another Toraja funeral on such a grand scale. The king's effigy is ready for its journey to the death cliff. The death house of Tuan Sangala is burned to the ground, freeing him to join his ancestors. The dynasty of the Toraja Star Children was ended, with the last king of the tribe making his long journey back to his home in the stars. But was it the end of their contact with another world, I wondered? What was behind these elaborate death rites? And I asked the hereditary high priest, who turned out to be my own age. The dead need some help, he said. They're usually reluctant to return to their source. They love this material world and the living, and they cling to them. For our old people, this thing about our ancestors descending from the stars was perfectly natural. It's harder to believe this nowadays. But in those times, perhaps the earth and the sky were still closer together. But you can look at it philosophically, too. The reason our coffins and houses are shaped like this is because we slide down into life, stay briefly, and slide on up again out of the material world.